falsify the studies. Case in point, psychiatrist Farouk Abuzahab, former ethics committee chair of the Minnesota Psychiatry Society, whose patient he recruited into one of his clinical trials, reported having extreme thoughts of suicide. In his research documents, however, he noted zero adverse events. 2 days later, she jumped from a Minneapolis bridge to her death. A final way of skewing test data is to hide unwanted drug reactions under less frightening terms. This trick was used in the notorious Paxil study 329, where such side effects as aggressive events, homicidal thoughts, and homicidal acts were categorized under the word hostility, while under the nebulous term emotional lability were filed suicidal thoughts and actions. In many cases, clinical trials are set up not to look for violence and suicide at all.
It is a problem that if these clinical trials don't specifically really ask a lot of questions about the nature of suicidal ideation and how the person feels and hopelessness and akathisia, if they don't ask those questions very specifically, they're not going to really get that data and it's not going to come up.
Designing biased trials to avoid negative findings, interpreting the raw data to favor your drug, and spinning the entire study to accentuate the positive are just some of the many, many ways to bias a trial. It is this perfect storm of intellectual dishonesty that has led one drug expert to conclude that it can be proven that most claimed research findings are false. But it is the drug companies that own the studies. And when they believe they have compiled enough evidence to convince regulators that their drug is safe and effective, they submit their phase 3 clinical trials for approval. The FDA only requires that 2 clinical trials be submitted, so drug companies can conduct as many studies as it takes to find the 2 that have the best chance at FDA approval.
You only need 2 positive trials against placebo, and it doesn't matter if you did 1,000, as long as you get 2. And it's amazing, sometimes they actually don't. They might pull data from another couple of clinical trials in order to get that approved.
They don't need to report all their data. They don't need to report all the trials that they do. They only need to report the ones that they want. They can handpick whichever one they want and then submit just those couple to the FDA.
As FDA Director of the Division of Neuropharmacological Drug Products, psychiatrist Paul Lieber complained, the sponsor could just do studies until the cows come home, until he gets 2 of them that are statistically significant by chance alone, walks them out, and says he had met the criteria.
The New England Journal published a study about a year ago showing that many clinical trials that had been conducted and registered with the Food and Drug Administration were never published because they came out showing no significant advantage over placebo. So antidepressants are not as effective as they are being made out to be, and the side effects are not as emphasized as much as they should be.
This point was driven home in 2008 by psychologist Irving Kirsch and his colleagues, who obtained every clinical trial ever submitted, published and unpublished, from the U.S. Food and Drug Administration of 4 new generation antidepressants. The results were both alarming and enlightening. In Kirsch's words, antidepressant medications have reported only modest benefits over placebo treatment. And when unpublished trial data are included, the benefit falls below accepted criteria for clinical significance. In addition to this, volumes of effects associated with these antidepressants have since been discovered, including homicide, suicide, and mass murder.
People really don't realize that from the beginning there's been a question of how marginally efficacious these drugs really are, apart from placebo.
And yet we have horrific side effects. Combine the 2, and where's your risk-to-benefit ratio? It's down the toilet.
But psychiatrists dismiss Kirsch's study because psychotropic drugs are big business, and clinical trials are a big part of that business. Take, for example, Martin Keller, former chair of the psychiatry department at Brown University, lead author of the so-called Paxil 329 study. This clinical trial, which tested hundreds of children on the antidepressant Paxil, found that the drug was generally well tolerated and effective, which in scientific terms is glowing praise. And the study's list of co-authors, 22 of the most prominent key opinion leaders in psychiatry.
I mean, that was a lot of people, but they were the who's who of psychiatry. And this was going to be a publication that I think, you know, took them, you know, into the end zone on getting their approval for kids.
With the FDA's blessing, Paxil became a blockbuster in the child and adolescent market, with sales of $55 million in 2002. It wasn't until the New York State Attorney General's office sued in 2004 that the truth finally came out. The raw data showed that not only was Paxil no more effective than placebo, but the young patients on Paxil were 6 times more likely to have suicidal thoughts. In fact, this data also revealed that 11 of the 93 children on the study developed serious side effects, of whom 7 had to be hospitalized. But according to Keller's own administrator, many of those children were either dropped from the study or coded as non-compliant to avoid having to be counted. While admitting no guilt, the drug company settled out of court for $2.5 million. Less money than Paxil was grossing every 7 hours. Hundreds of civil suits followed, but when Dr. Keller, as lead author of the Paxil 329 study, was deposed by attorneys, he would not admit to much.
I can't remember exactly what I said. I don't remember anything specific about any of these meetings. If my name wasn't on the top, I wouldn't remember ever having seen it. If I saw them, I don't remember. The answer is, I don't remember. I don't recall if I was. I don't recall asking him, which isn't to say that I didn't.
I want to pick up on the question Mr. Coffin asked you about the fivefold increase of the Paxil kids experiencing suicidality over the placebo kids. Do you recall those questions?
I do.
And you said that you weren't particularly aware of that except for with regard to a manuscript that was sent to you in confidence by GSK?
Correct.
That actually is not correct, though. I mean, this was an issue that had been presented to you by a number of different reporters that you personally responded to. Is that correct?
I don't remember.
How could Dr. Keller have known so little about the drug study of which he was lead author, and which he himself used to promote Paxil for children in prominent medical journals and conferences?
The ultimate publication of Study 329 was ghostwritten by an agency hired by GlaxoSmithKline, and eventually they, after the manuscript was written, they put Martin Keller's name on it as an author.
You know, there again, maybe you can tell me where I can find it in the paper.
No, I'm asking you if you were aware.
I don't remember the specifics.
And then we finally showed him a document from GlaxoSmithKline where GlaxoSmithKline says that the study was entirely flawed. It was a complete failed study, and it certainly didn't show that Paxil was remarkably efficacious for treating children and adolescents in depression.
Can you read that into the record, please?
Essentially, the study did not really show Paxil was effective in treating adolescent depression, comma, which is not something we want to publicize.
We asked him, with that information now, you know, how can you tell us that it would be okay and safe to give a kid Paxil? And he couldn't answer the question. He sat back, he put his head in his hands, and for, you know, the longest 2 minutes sat there silent.
During the last 2 years of his Paxil study, Keller personally pocketed $1 million in drug company money, none of which he disclosed in his published research.
When people look at the field of psychiatry and they hear all these reports in the New York Times and Boston Globe, and they see this psychiatrist or this psychologist, you know, took money and didn't disclose it, they wonder, well, is this causing a biases, you know, in the field? I think that's a legitimate concern of the public because of the fact that it is true.
With this level of corruption pervading the testing of psychotropic drugs, one is left with a question. Where are those who are entrusted with our protection? Government regulators are supposed to watch out for patients' welfare. So why are so many dangerous psychotropic drugs being allowed on the market? At one point, the U.S. Food and Drug Administration was considered the gold standard in drug safety. But this is no longer the case with psychotropic drugs, where psychiatrists and drug companies have virtually taken over the approval process. FDA drug advisory panels that recommend the approval of psychotropic drugs have long been filled with psychiatrists with financial ties to drug companies. One study showed that 92% of FDA advisory meetings in the last decade included at least one member with conflicts of interest. In response to the accusation of conflict of interest, the FDA says that they have tried to find mental health experts without drug industry connections, but can't locate any. To solve this, they issue waivers, where a psychiatrist is allowed to sit on a psychotropic drug advisory panel, despite having a financial conflict of interest of up to $50,000 a year with drug companies.
The advisory panels that review drugs, most of these people are direct recipients of money from usually the drug understudy, the company that's submitting the drug, and they waive the conflicts most of the time. So it's pretty pervasive, and it's quite insidious.
Full waivers have been granted to the following participants: Dr. Andrew Leon, for his role as a member of a data safety monitoring board for an affected firm. He receives between $10,001 and $50,000 per year. Dr. Bruce Pollock has been granted a limited waiver for his activities on an advisory board and speakers bureau for an affected firm in which he receives less than $10,001 per year. Ms. Jean Bronstein, for her ownership of stock and a bond in an affected firm in which the value falls between $50,001 and $100,000.
You could be paid massive amounts of money by the drug companies, you know, in this sense, and then turn your head here and say, okay, now I'm going to review the drug. And that huge conflict of interest was not to be discussed. In fact, they didn't want people putting it out there. That was the policy. So they still allow it. They still allow that conflict to continue. But now it's meant to, you know, I guess they're supposed to acknowledge if there's a conflict of interest. But acknowledging the conflict and getting rid of the conflict are two different things.
The revolving door between government, academia, and the drug industry is one of psychiatry's worst-kept secrets.
The revolving door, FDA and drug. So we have a system where those institutions that people trust, want to trust, would like to trust, are truly untrustworthy.
Case in point, Daniel Troy, a former drug company lobbyist, who was then hired as general counsel for the FDA, where he filed legal briefs in favor of drug companies and against drug victims.
He was the drug lobbyist lawyer, and then he became the general counsel of the FDA. I mean, they talk about having the wolf watch the chickens.
After leaving the FDA, Daniel Troy went back to the drug industry, where he is now senior vice president and general counsel for pharmaceutical giant GlaxoSmithKline. This is the atmosphere under which psychiatrists at the FDA give drug makers approval to sell psychotropic drugs. But the clinical trials are not supposed to end here. There is one final stage of testing to go, phase four. Phase 4 requires that drug companies track the adverse side effects that will undoubtedly occur in the general public, well beyond the very small samples of Phase 3.